You're listening to the Franchise Freedom Podcast with Giuseppe Grammatico.
Okay, and welcome to the Franchise Freedom Podcast. I'm your host, Giuseppe Grammatico, your franchise guide. And today we have a very special guest. Today we are speaking with David Alto. And just a quick little biography on David. David trains and provides HR, marketing, CEOs, and job-seeking professionals on how to position themselves, their departments, and organizations on LinkedIn. He empowers and promotes the talents and experiences of those individuals and businesses looking to accomplish their career and organizational goals and excel in their professional in their profession and industry. His positioning statement, advancing businesses with personal solutions, and clients past, present, and future are the inspiration and his passion. David, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. That was good. We're done.
That's it. We're done. That's it. And look up David on LinkedIn. Now, We was on David's show yesterday. We had a blast. We went live, so inspiring me to potentially. I signed up with StreamYard and I've gone live twice out of 100 episodes. So definitely. I'm going to need your advice after the show, so I'll hit you up for that.
No worries, no worries.
Give the so a lot of the audience are, you know, corporate executives trying to figure out if the next step is a job, if the next a different job, or the next step is a business. Talk to us a little bit about your transition from employee to employer and what that journey's looked like.
Sure. So let's see. Back early 2019, I was, to be honest, I was afraid the company I was working with was going to sell or franchise. So, downsizing potentially. So I got on LinkedIn, was providing little tips and tricks, you know. I was still writing resumes on the side, just part-time, but really just posting engaging content, leadership, interviewing advice, just whatever I could. And, you know, I just developed a little bit of a following and started still continuing to write resumes for people for free just until one person landed a really decent job with the resume that I wrote for free. He says, "I got to pay you." I'm like, "No." And he's like, "Yeah, I do." So he paid me. And then that was it. Then I started, you know, hustling. But the reason I bring that up is it was much easier looking back, even though I worked about 55 plus hours a week, 5.5 days a week in my day job and working maybe 20 hours a week in this side hustle, trying to see if it was going to work. If it didn't, I didn't care. But looking back, that struggle of working a little bit too much really allowed me to see that I could potentially make this a career. Every month I was doing a little bit more. In December 2019, left my day job to do this full time. And I knew, because I could see the amount of time I was investing and the return on that, I knew if I was doing it full time, I could make a decent living. Maybe not right away what I was making before, but I see people, you know, just quitting their job and then starting their business. So I kind of started my business while working.
Yeah.
And that really, again, that made for an easier transition. So whether you're, you know, thinking about buying a franchise or doing, being an entrepreneur. If you can not just quit cold turkey, if you can do a little bit, I promise the struggle is real. I promise working kind of two jobs there, but you can fine tune things. You don't have to, you know, you're not so reliant on, you know, you quit your day job and you have no income. Right. So, that was a much easier transition for me doing it that way.
Yeah, that's interesting. I get the question all the time, which is better? And I say it depends on your situation. For me, I was commuting into the city 5 hours door to door round trip, and I said it was impossible. It was just because I'd be on a train or a bus depending on what I was taking that month. But I had And in full disclosure, my wife was working full time. We had, son on the way later that year or so. But there's no right or wrong. It's really, do you have the income? Do you have the buffer? And to your point, yes, you have the job and the stability, and you can play with things and try to figure out, okay, should I go about it? Should I be on Facebook? Should I be on LinkedIn? Which is kind of the next topic I want to get into. Something I find really interesting with all the different platforms. So, why LinkedIn? There's so many great platforms out there. Why did you kind of narrow in or hone in on LinkedIn?
Sure. So, back early 2019, I was kind of looking for my next career while I still, had a job. Mm-hmm. So obvious LinkedIn, right? But what I realized what LinkedIn wasn't, because still to this day, and this, people still think it's this boring business platform, but you can share literally whatever you want. And right. I have found by literally posting as much as you want and sharing things about you, people develop relationships when they get to know you. So if you're taking a video while you're on vacation or talking about your dog, believe it or not, on LinkedIn, that is okay. It's okay to share pictures or whatever. Some of my best posts, the video might be funny, but the text might be related to what I'm, what I'm right. discussing. So, that just intrigues them to stop and look and then interact. But what I have found, and other people prove this, that there is way more engagement on posts than on any other platform. On Facebook, you might get a like, you might get a, that was cool. But you don't usually get the conversation. And that's where you can nurture those relationships by engaging with content of others. And I still to this day spend the first hour of the day engaging with content of the people that are in my little circle. And way before I post, actually, it's better for the algorithm too. But I enjoy, some of the friends and people that I've met, and I enjoy engaging on their content. But that's the best way, if you were going to get started on LinkedIn, is just to engage with others, businesses, hashtags that you want to follow. That's the best way to build that network initially.
That is very interesting. I didn't realize with the engagement, it's more on LinkedIn. And there's so many different things to know. I mean, I got extremely overwhelmed as I post on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. And well, you're supposed to include the link in the post. Then you're supposed to include it in the comments. And there's too many rules. And they said to really, if you can, ultimately stick with one platform and then eventually learn the others. But until you master one platform, you should really try to focus on one. But to your point, I post the same content, which I know is a no-no, and I admit it, and all the platforms. But to your point, now that you mention it, and it's funny now that we're talking, we never talked about this prior. I do get more engagement, I get more maybe likes on Facebook, but that's it, no comments. But I'm getting the engagement and conversation. So that is very interesting. So when I looked at LinkedIn, and I think a lot of people do as well, I owned a business. I started my first business back in 2007. And then I said, well, LinkedIn really isn't for me. That's more if you're looking for a job. But then I found that, no, that's my identity. You need that profile. That should be updated. And that's something I did with a friend of mine. We updated the profile years ago. And we try our best to keep up to date with it. So talk to us, how do you help people in that process? Because I know some people, what they post, I still to this day see people posting without even a picture, which is, I think, is one of the most important things. Is you need to have that picture. That's you, right? It's your photo, not sure. Your bio, but your photo and the bio. So why is that important? And how do you help people, set that profile up?
Sure. Let's talk about the picture just for a second. If you go to a networking event, you do not go to that networking event with a bag over your head.
Right.
Okay. Right. Okay. Right. You get to know people. You shake their hand. Well, right. maybe, because of COVID, maybe you don't. Maybe you fit, air fist bump or whatever. Right. But you meet people, you look them in the eyes, and you smile. So we have to see your eyes, and you have to be smiling, in that photo. And how do I help people? Listen, people just do not realize, and they do not treat their LinkedIn profile like their own free personal branding website. We're branding you, not where you work. If you work at Amazon, you know, a lot of people might have the Amazon logo on their banner. Well, that just tells people where you work. That doesn't say what you do. There's, you know, there's the audio message. Now you can add a video to your photo. The headline is the is really SEO for recruiters. When recruiters are going and looking for people, the content that you put in there matters. It is super valuable real estate. There's just so many more things that you can share. And let's face it, there's 830 million people on LinkedIn, something like that. Most people don't have a profile that takes advantage of everything. So if that recruiter or hiring manager or everybody on LinkedIn is here to sell. Now, let me explain. If you're a job seeker, you're here to sell yourself.
Right.
B2B happens. B2C happens. Everything and anything happens on LinkedIn. So we need to brand you to sell you. If you're a CEO, why does it benefit you to have a LinkedIn great LinkedIn profile? Well, you might occasionally, you know, talk to the vendors and investors, and the better you show up, not talking about posting, just your profile, the better you show up, the better you represent your company. Maybe you're an account manager and you get leads for your company on LinkedIn. Mm-hmm. Well, you want a great picture, you know, you don't want sunglasses on and or cropped out person at a wedding because you can't go and take a photo outside in portrait mode and you know, have somebody snap that and put that up there just real quick. So there's just so many things that people just do not realize they can leverage on LinkedIn to make to show up better, to be honest.
I like that. Yeah. And it's a very good point. I had someone else on the show a couple months ago. We talked about, you know, H to H, human to human marketing, and it's, you know, a personal brand. So if you own a franchise or other business, maybe the marketing is done for you, but what is your personal brand? Because you may get into consulting and other businesses, and people do business with who they like and trust. So you need to have that personal brand, representation on LinkedIn, so people can find you and say, well, I had a great experience with Giuseppe or David doing, you know, resume writing or helping me with my profile. What else can they help me with when they notice you're in other businesses? So very well said. And that's something I learned recently and I'm always trying to work on. Switching gears a little bit. Actually, before we even do that, this is still pretty new. We have a quick note from one of our sponsors. So bear with us. We hope you're enjoying the show. This episode of Franchise Freedom is brought to you by the SMBPodcastNetwork.com. The network is a collection of podcasts and shows from around the internet, which focus on bringing you interviews with amazing guests who share actionable advice, ideas, and information for small and medium-sized business owners and entrepreneurs. Visit www.smbpodcastnetwork.com to find more great shows and easily subscribe to be notified of new episodes. It's a great way to discover quality content. If you discovered us today via the network, then I hope you're enjoying the show and will consider subscribing directly so you never miss any of our great episodes. Now back to the show. All right, we are back. That is a new sponsor, something new we're trying and a great resource for people that are exploring business ownership and want to learn a little bit more about that. Switching gears a little bit, what have you seen? You know, you work with numerous applicants and people, I'm sure, messaging you daily across the United States. What have you been seeing with employment? Kind of a state of employment. Are you getting more and more people asking to redo resumes? Are there more job openings out there? What have you seen out there?
Sure. So for job seekers, it is a good time this summer. Let me explain in a minute, but yes, we're seeing companies thinking about laying off. We're seeing companies not posting as much jobs, but this is the best time to find a job because, let's face it, what happened this year? Well, COVID's more under control, meaning people are going on vacation more. So if you're a job seeker and you're actively applying, there's going to be less people applying this summer. So there's still companies that are looking to hire, but we have been seeing some slowdown in hiring. But again, don't, if you're actively looking, it is a great time because we're going to see fewer applicants. And I've talked to a couple of recruiters over the last few weeks, and yes, they are getting less applicants. Mm-hmm. So it is tougher on them. But again, if you're way more than qualified, you got already an amazing resume, amazing LinkedIn, you're going to do just well. Companies still have to pay top dollar for people more than ever to get great talent, because pre-COVID, you know, companies had choice A, B, and C. And so they didn't have to, they could, you know, the salary range didn't have to be extremely high. But now, you know, they find, you know, Steve or Stephanie, and that's the only really person they like. Well, they got to offer him or her a little bit more so that they do say yes. So again, slow down a little bit, but less people applying. September, boy, oh boy, if you wait till September to apply, then you're going to be competing with even more people. And then we're going to see more jobs open up.
So the moral of the story is that aside from what's going on, still have to have everything in order, still apply. You had mentioned recruiters, and I wanted to touch on that, but the services you offer, you know, if you can maybe list how you can help someone from, you know, A to Z, and do you work with recruiters? Do you make any introductions to recruiters, or do you just work with them as far as finding out what they're looking for?
Sure. I'll touch on that, the recruiter part last. Okay. So listen, you do have to have a solid resume, because the resume gets you a potential call, right? So I help people through that. I enjoy writing resumes. Now, some people say I'm crazy because it does take hours, but it's almost like being a detective. If you know what jobs that they're going to be applying for, I used to be a hiring manager. I did a lot of interviews. So I can see that resume and know what I need to include in order to get noticed. And if I have those jobs that I know that you're going to be interested in applying, then I make your resume say that you know how to, you know, do those new jobs. When it comes to recruiters, I share with all of my clients, and I'll share this today, reaching out to recruiters, they get bombarded by people all the time. So you can bypass recruiters and be way more effective in the job search. Mm-hmm. Let's say you're applying for a project manager position at Amazon. LinkedIn is the only database, and that's how you have to think of the 830 million as this big, huge database. You can search for on LinkedIn. You can search for people that work as project managers at Amazon. Reach out to them, and it could be like, hey, Giuseppe, I see that you work at Amazon as a project manager. I was just curious to learn a little bit more about your experience in the company culture. Thank you in advance. Mm-hmm. You message more than a few people. Let's say you reply. I say, hey, thank you for replying. I did have a question. Recently, I seen a position open as a project manager with Amazon. Based on my LinkedIn profile, my work experience, my education, do you think I'd be a good fit and should I apply? You're not asking any favors, but then guess what? That person potentially could get a referral bonus. Mm-hmm. You know, potentially. I used this step a very long time ago, way before I was active on LinkedIn. Somebody gave me that little tip that landed me an interview all the way to the end. I didn't end up getting the job, but this step works because these people are not like recruiters and getting bombarded, you know, and financially they might get a referral. This is just not something that is normally used on LinkedIn, but it is super easy. Within under a minute, you will find these people working at this company, whatever, at that job title. And you message more than a few, you're going to hear back from a few.
Right.
And that might lead, you know, to an interview or a discovery call or whatever. So that is such a good, better, best practice, and way better than ever messaging recruiters.
Interesting. And talk and as far as recruiters go, do you work with recruiter directly with recruiters? You had mentioned that, you know, you obviously have conversations with them. So as part of your service, is there any involvement with recruiter? Or are you more just getting kind of feedback from them as to what's out there, advice, recommendations?
Sure. It's more feedback, but, you know, I have a large network on LinkedIn. I just hit 79,000 followers today.
Wow.
But I have 24,000 connections. You max out at 30,000 eventually. But when my clients are connected to me, they're only one person away from those 24,000 connections, and that's me. Mm-hmm. So I encourage my clients to seek out different people. And what if I am connected to a recruiter that works at Amazon in right. this part of the country? Then I can make an introduction, yes, but you shouldn't go chasing after recruiters, because a lot of times they just don't respond. They get too many messages. Mm. You know, if I know them well, they're going to respond to me and know that I'm only right. going to give. So do I work with them? Maybe indirectly, more as a just helping them facilitate that, you know, that initial conversation if I happen to have, you know, that connection at that organization.
Gotcha. Okay. Talk to us. So you know, we've been talking for a while, and I've been following you on LinkedIn, and you talk a lot about the bots. Who are these bots? Are robots chasing us on LinkedIn? What's going on? Because I keep hearing this, bots and people getting sent to LinkedIn jail. But talk to us a little bit more about that, because I need some clarification as well.
All right. Well, I'll talk about the LinkedIn jail with the bots. So a lot of recruiters aren't going to like what I'm about to say, because no, there is no like robot that stands at the gates of Amazon when you apply to reject but it feels that way. And on my LinkedIn, you know, profile, on my banner, I got an ATS robot in a headlock. It's just a playful attempt. But most companies, when I say most, well over 90% of all companies use some type of software, and they might filter based on hard and soft skills, or a recruiter goes in and filters those 400 applicants. Show me the ones that have, you know, project management, right? You know, product management, you know, operations management or whatever. So you want to make sure. Now, you could do it old school way, print the job description. Start at the bottom first, because that's where a lot of the necessary skills are at, and then work your way up. But just make sure that you have all of those high-level skills on your resume. You don't want to word your resume to death full of just keywords. Right. But that's where it comes in. You know, for me, I compare that job description that my clients give me to the resume that I create for them. I look and identify missing hard and soft skills, transferable skills, place those in there. And, you know, my clients have a pretty good chance of getting that phone to ring, and they do, because they tell me, and you know, where's the proof? You know, people say, well, how do I know you're going to, and that's easy. You go down to the bottom of my LinkedIn profile and look at the recommendations that I've received, and more than a few. But regardless, if you're going to hire anybody and they have a LinkedIn account, those recommendations down at the bottom are a great way. Think of it as a Yelp review.
Right.
That's a great way for you to see who they've helped and how they've helped them.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So that's actually some really good advice. Never thought of it that way. But I mean, anytime, I know when I had employees, I would look them up online, right, and check out their LinkedIn. And that's a very good point. Another thing you mentioned, which I have always done, but I know a lot of people don't, is you don't just have one resume. You have one main resume. But when you apply for a job, to your point, to make sure the bots are scanning the right terms and words, but you need to cater it for that job, correct? I mean, there may be some tweaks.
Sure.
To an extent.
Most people only apply for maybe two or three different types of roles.
Okay.
So I've had success, a lot of resume writers have, you should be able to have one resume that speaks that you can do multiple roles. Now, maybe not eight.
Right.
But what I try to do is by knowing what jobs you're going to apply for, allows me to tweak maybe, and not saying anything that you don't already know or do, but word it so that they understand, you know, hey, you know this job, depending on, you know, who's reading it, you apply for a different job. So that initial summary, not an objective statement, we left that go a long time ago, but that initial summary after your name and contact information, even if it's one or two or three small paragraphs, if that can kind of recap your career, I know it's hard to do in, you know, a couple paragraphs, but if that can really recap your career and they understand what you know, how you solve it, and even again, multiple positions, that should be enough. Now, maybe you are looking at that job description to add a little keyword or a skill. You right. see that you don't have this. So what it means by tailoring it, it's not totally redoing it. I know people that spend hours revamping their resume for one job.
Right.
I don't think you have to be that crazy. But again, if that resume writer knows two or three different types of positions mm-hmm. that you're going to be applying for, you should really only have to have one resume and then just briefly
right.
look at that job description.
Okay. No, that makes a lot of sense. And that's extremely helpful. Save people a ton of time. What have we not talked about today? I know we kind of talked at a very high level, and you work, you're going to work with people obviously to work on their one-stop shop, right? Resume, LinkedIn profile, getting some great LinkedIn general advice, free advice as to tips and what you should be doing. What other advice or anything else we didn't cover today that you'd like to share with the audience?
Sure. So regardless of what you do at your organization, I do help some companies. They'll come to me and then go, okay, we're a fairly new startup and we don't understand LinkedIn. So again, everybody's here to sell. So having your department heads all having a great profile will attract new clients, vendors, whatever. So really making sure your teams either go through some kind of webinar or paid training courses regarding LinkedIn. I do some Zoom calls with multiple people. But you really, regardless of what you do, showing up on LinkedIn will help, whether you're an entrepreneur or you work for, you know, whatever you do, because we're all here to sell something on LinkedIn. So showing up better, it is going to benefit you. And if you just take a little bit of time away from Facebook or some other things, you know, some other platforms, and you spend a little bit here, I think that you'll find that LinkedIn is not this boring business platform that people still think it is.
Right. No, very, very well put. Before I want to share with everyone how they can get a hold of you and kind of the best way. Interesting fact about David Alto.
Oh, geez. Well, in 2 weeks' time, I am going to get my certification in spinning. You know, spinning classes at the gym. I've been an avid, not outside but inside cycler for about 10 years. So I'm about to get certified, and then I'll teach very, very, very part time at the club. So that's new to everybody. I have not announced that anywhere except here with you. So
you're hearing it first here at the Franchise Freedom Podcast. There's a first for everything. So I have not tried spinning, but I've seen the classes, and wow, they are intense. They are at a friend of mine and share a video of the class. And I was like, wow, this is something else. So awesome. What is the best way for people to get in touch with you? Because it sounds like anyone, you know, really any, if you are listening in today, or just everyone needs a LinkedIn profile. And I'm sure you do reviews and kind of rewrites and things like that. So what is the best way they can reach you?
Sure. Yeah, if you message me on Facebook or Instagram, there could be a good chance that I will not respond for like 3 weeks.
Right.
So I, even though I post, I am all in on LinkedIn. The easiest way is to either, you know, connect with me or just DM me. I'm going to respond same day. And that is absolutely the best way for you to be able to connect with me.
Awesome. So I will, I'll put all the information in the show notes and obviously send David a message. I'm sure you guys will connect and figure out what's the best approach. And I'm glad we were speaking today. I've learned, I've actually taken some notes. I got the pencil out. So I'm always learning from the shows, and I definitely encourage everyone to reach out to David. And again, all show notes, everything will, all David's information will be in the show notes. Maybe we won't even include Facebook, right? Just we'll keep it to LinkedIn. We won't even include the Instagram, unless you want that delayed reply. And I'm the same way. I don't check those as much. Someone said I have to get on TikTok, and I'm like, that's where I draw the line. I don't even, there's no reason I should be on there. So, or maybe I'm missing something, but maybe that I'll have someone on from TikTok, on the next episode. But, thank you very much. It was a pleasure being on your show. Been looking forward to this, and I really appreciate it. I'm going to steal some of the advice for my LinkedIn, and looking forward to having a future conversation.
Oh yeah, thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Take care.
Thanks for tuning in. Whenever you're ready, here are three ways Giuseppe can help. 1, if you've ever considered owning a business of any kind, you owe it to yourself to get a copy of Giuseppe's book, Franchise Freedom. Download your free copy at ggthefranchiseguide.com/book. 2, want to understand how successful executives make the transition from corporate to owning their own franchise? Join Giuseppe's next online presentation, Franchise Freedom, How to Escape the Corporate World and Have Financial and Time Freedom by Owning a Franchise, by going to ggthefranchiseguide.com/video. 3, want to work with Giuseppe one-on-one to identify the right franchise opportunity for you, to navigate the process, and get plugged into experienced franchising advisors? Send him an email to gg@ggthefranchiseguide.com with one-on-one in the subject, and he'll send you all the details.